Good afternoon. I am Shawnee Klein, a senior account manager at the AWWA Research Foundation. I would like to thank all of the subscribers and members of the media which are joining us today to learn more about Quagga and zebra mussel control strategies. Today we are going to be hearing from three speakers, each of which attended and spoke at the workshop on Quagga and zebra mussel control strategies for water users in the western U.S., which was co-hosted in April of this year by Southern Nevada Water Authority, the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California, and AWARF. A couple of quick technical items before I introduce our speakers. If you're having any technical difficulties, you can press the upper right-hand area of your screen, which is the help key, or you can also call 1-866-709-8255, or you can email tsc@talkpoint.com. I would also encourage you to please submit your questions for the speakers, which we will do our best to answer at the end of the webcast. Any questions that are not answered during the webcast will be answered offline and posted on our website at awwarf.org. If you think of questions following the webcast, I would also encourage you to send them directly to me, and I will get them answered for you at sklein@awarf.org. And if you didn't get that down, you can certainly find me on our website under our staff listing. So our first speaker today is Renata Claudi. Ms. Claudi is a biologist with over 20 years of diverse business and technical experience. At this time, she is the chief scientist of RNT Consulting, Inc. This environmental consulting firm focuses on the various aspects of alien species invasions, including their economic impact, risk of introductions, selection of appropriate control options, and their installation. Ms. Claudi received her BS and MS degrees in marine biology from McGill University in Montreal, Quebec. And from 1989 to 2000, she worked for a major Canadian electrical utility. There she was responsible for the assessment of impact of zebra mussels on the operating system and development of mitigation plans, interaction with other utilities and industries, organization of major scientific meetings. She was also one of the chief organizers of numerous international conferences on aquatic nuisance species. Ms. Claudi has edited and co-edited various books and papers on invasive species, including Alien Invaders in Canada's Waters, Wetlands, and Forests, published by the Natural Resources of Canada in 2004, Freshwater Alien Organisms in North America, published by Lewis Publishers in 1999, and she also co-authored the Practical Manual for Zebra Mussel Control and Monitoring and Control, which was published by Lewis Publishers in 1993. And with that, I will happily hand it over to Ms. Claudi.
Well, thank you very much, Johnny. Hi there, everyone out there inside the space. This is my first time doing a webcast, and I must say I do prefer a live, interactive audience to the computer screen. So please bear with me. I really do a much better job in person, but I will try my very best. So to launch right into the presentation, I will cover a bit of the environmental requirements of the mussels, and I will zip quickly to what assets are at risk from infestation, and probably spend the rest of the presentation discussing various control options that are available out there. So here are some of the basic requirements of the zebra and quagga mussels, which form the Dreissenid family. Basically, this is of particular interest to people who are either expecting an infestation or who are just starting to experience one. It is really worthwhile to examine the environment that's out there and see if any of these factors could be a mitigating factor for infestation in the future. Water temperature in particular, down south in the United States, can have a profound effect on the settlement, or rather the non-settlement of the larval stages. Calcium levels are pretty much an undisputed must. If you have less than 15 milligrams per liter in your water source, you're probably not going to be experiencing much of an infestation. pH levels are also very important, and as is dissolved oxygen. There are some basic requirements that these mussels have, and although they are tough and prolific, if you do not meet these basic requirements, you might not have much of a problem. One of the rules of thumb that we do use is that if you have corbicula, which is the Asian clam, or the native unionid mussels in the water source at this time, then probably the zebra mussels and quagga mussels will do quite nicely. because the requirements that these two species have compared to the dry sennets are very, very similar. So that's a kind of rule of thumb that we use in the absence of actual hard environmental data that may be present. So the... excuse me, see, I'm messing it up already. I'm backing up one slide. So coming back to the zebra and quagga mussels, they have two particularly nasty characteristics when it comes to water users, raw water users. One is the fact that they have a free-living larval stage, which can float in the water as part of the plankton. It can be drawn into whatever facility through most available strainers and most available filters even, and basically set up shop once it gets past them. The other characteristic is that it is the only family of freshwater mussels in North America at this time that has a holdfast. The holdfast are the little hairs that you see on the adult mussel. And with these, they can cling on to surfaces and basically not get dislodged by anything much except pressure wash systems. So those two characteristics make the dry sennet family of mussels of particular concern to raw water users of all descriptions. Because of the ability to cling to surfaces and because of the fact that they have the free-swimming young, they can be moved around with a number of different ways. They definitely cling to all kinds of recreational watercraft. They are part of the bait bucket if you take water from an infested lake. They can be part of aquaculture transfers, and they also move through canals and waterways, basically going downstream from wherever they originate to wherever they may end up. Because of this ability to move around rather quickly, they have managed to conquer most of the east coast of North America very shortly after they arrived in 1986. As you can see, the red dots being on the east side of the continent, they have gone from the Great Lakes and down all the way down to Baton Rouge in Louisiana, and they have moved as far as they could along the St. Lawrence River, right to where it meets a saltwater interface. But they stayed on the east side of the continental divide for a very long time, and they have only hopped across it quite recently, and those are the green stars and yellow stars that you see on the left-hand side of the map. And despite the fact that we have had to deal with them on the east coast for a long time, they came as a bit of a shock to the west coast. So just to, based on the experience that we have from the east coast, the basic problem that the mussels cause to raw water users is decrease of flow. And there is a potential for plugging of all kinds of essential systems. And also, underneath the mussel colonies, there is an opportunity for increased corrosion for materials of construction. So those three things are quite difficult to cope with. In terms of actual systems at risk, basically, anything that is exposed to the raw water out there, external structures of all descriptions and of all materials of construction, as well as any internal piping that is exposed to raw water and which carries that water at less than 6 feet per second. If the water flow is over 6 feet per second, the young larvae, the veligers, are not able to settle down. So that's the basic problem. So that's a pretty broad category. So we're looking at basically anything from the intake water structures to cooling water to fire protection, any instruments that use raw water, any civil structures that are out there. All those systems are at various degrees of risk from mussels settling on them and interfering with their function. There are two basic mechanisms of fouling. One is the settlement of the larval form, which are called the veligers, during the breeding season, which in some cases may be up to 10 months of the year. And basically any veliger that comes is ready to settle down and comes into contact with a available surface will put down roots and grow in place. There is also a second mechanism of fouling, which is not as well known, and that is the migration of adults from one area to another by cutting those thistle threads that we talked about earlier and reattaching itself in another location. We had a very good example of it at the Parker Dam on the Lower Colorado River last fall. We put out some sampling pipe coupons, as you see on the picture here. The four on the left were in the water column. The one on the right was actually touching the face of the dam. The face of the dam was heavily colonized already, and basically the mussel saw an available surface that was not crowded and moved onto it. So there is quite a lot of mobility to the adults, which a lot of people don't remember. Okay. So in terms of impact, what we basically see first, if you start seeing settlement in your pipe, you will not necessarily start to lose flow, but what you do experience is an increased roughness on the inside of the piping, and that means that you have to pump a little harder because the coefficient of friction is increasing. Following that, of course, is shell coming in from upstream, and then as the mussels grow in place, you may start actually losing flow. Here are some examples of structures that were fouled on the East Coast, anything from concrete pump wells to trash racks that are almost completely occluded by mussel fouling, and it just goes on and on. In terms of the internal systems, the external structures are a problem, but you can get to them to clean them. The internal systems tend to be more of a problem because you can't clean them as easily. The mechanism of fouling for the internal systems is very similar to the ones on the external. There is the larval veligers that come into contact with the surfaces. There is adult mussels that can be floating in the water and reattaching themselves. And they can also come, the adult mussels, in clumps, rolling along and being drawn into water systems. So the mechanisms of fouling are very similar. So is the impact. Basically, we are seeing decrease in system pipe diameter and loss of flow in these systems. The plugging of heat exchangers with clumps or individual shells is something that happens very frequently. Blockage of system valves is a problem because mussels can attach to either the seat or the valve and basically interfere with operation. And in some cases, when there was a lot of settlement, even secondary systems such as building drains have been known to become fairly heavily fouled. Here is an example of one of the condensers where clumps of mussels have basically been flowing along in a large pipe with lots of flow till it met the small diameter orifice, and the clumps of mussels at this point plug that orifice, and it really doesn't matter if the mussels are alive or dead. The only way you're going to get them out of there is with mechanical cleaning. Here's another example of a water box of a large condenser. The mussels that you see sort of in the corners have grown in place, but then you also see individual mussels and mussel clumps that are blocking the little diameter pipes in the opening. The little blue balls, by the way, are supposed to be cleaning those tubes. Obviously, if with the mussels in place, these little balls are not doing a lot. Here is another scary picture where there is a lot of shell debris that has come in from another area plugging a heat exchanger. Here is an example of a pump bell that is not, the pump has not been used very heavily, and it has been hanging into the pump well, with a lot of settlement taking place. Obviously, the people in this area have a large infestation that they have to deal with, and this, by the way, is fouling that has accumulated during one single year. One of the systems that causes a lot of problems to me is fire protection systems. Fire protection systems are generally very vulnerable to any kind of particulate matter that might be drawn in, including shells, because they have a lot of small orifices, small strainers, and sprinkler nozzles have very small orifices as well. The fire protection systems can be colonized either by villagers coming in, and if the fire system is not maintained at a static state where there is a decline in the oxygen level inside the system, these villagers may actually grow within the fire protection system itself, which is really bad news. One of the first places that one worries about with fire protection system is the main fire pumps, which would be the red pump on the right. In this case, it's a large electrical pump that has a fixed grate on it, which may be grown over by mussels in between use. Following the pump is what is a deluge strainer, which collects any debris that may be coming in, and it is likely or could be plugged by shell debris. Further into the system, as I mentioned before, sprinkler nozzles may become plugged by particles of shell. Fire hose nozzles and fire hydrants have been known to spit mussel shells, adult mussel shells, if the fire systems are not maintained properly. So fire systems need to be paid a particular attention to during an infestation of the quagga or zebra mussels. And the best possible way is to make sure that the systems are static. So moving right along, the next asset that needs to be protected is any instrumentation that is in direct contact with raw water. If at all possible, if those instruments can be changed into non-contact instruments, you will be better off in the long run. One of the places where we saw adult mussels was in this thrust-bearing sight glass, leading up to some coolers in a hydraulic power plant. It is a good way to check if you have mussels or not, but it really isn't doing the system any good. Direct contact gauges in places like aqueducts or pump wells, again, if you can switch from a direct contact to a non-contact instrumentation, so much better. Of course, one cannot forget the civil structure. Municipal fire hydrants that may be drawing from an open water source, irrigation systems, recharge areas, locks and dams, buoys, floating docks, all those systems will be at risk, and if they are part of your assets, they need to be protected. Now, I have mentioned that the macrofouling by mussels can increase corrosion rates on materials of construction, and it's basically three different mechanisms by which this happens. All of them are problematic, and in many cases, if the materials of construction are already in not a particularly good shape, it is much better to prevent the settlement of mussels on those structures than to try to clean them off periodically and expose new unpastivated surfaces to attack of microbial corrosion. Industrial systems are not the only systems that are at risk from quagga and zebra mussel infestation. There are profound changes that have taken place in the East when mussels have come into the system. There is such things as increase in clarity, which for most people, they say, oh, the mussels have cleaned up the lake or the river. But unfortunately, the fish that really like it murky and rely on the system to be murky to hunt don't particularly like it. Also, there is a much greater increase in submerged vegetation based on the fact that there is sunlight penetrating all the way to the bottom of these systems. There is removal of green algae by mussel filtering, which gives rise to it gives the heads up to blue-green algae, and we have had some significant blooms of blue-green algae in the area, which in turn causes problems to the drinking water providers because of taste and odor problems that blue-green algae bring with them. So, all in all, I think that reviewing the impact that the mussels can have on the various assets it is really a good idea to minimize just how much settlement you will allow in your various facilities. Basically, when you talk about control of mussels, you have two choices. You may either be proactive and prevent settlement, either on the external structures or inside the plant, or you can decide that it really doesn't bother you that much and you will only treat when you have seen settlement, or rather you're going to be reacting to what's going on out there. If you choose proactive or reactive way of dealing with the mussel infestation, basically you should be using some evaluation criteria. Every facility is different and every facility prefers to operate in a certain way. It is really only your decision that can decide which way you're going to go. You need to decide how much your system can tolerate in terms of mussel shells and mussel fouling. If there is any blockage to that will cause either regulatory or environmental or safety concerns, and how your customers, regulators, or insurers will view this, and what is your operational preference. So there is a set of criteria that I encourage every facility to go through before they decide on the best available treatment for that facility. One of the myths that are out there is that all facilities are the same, which of course we know they're not. Another one is that engineering staff has all the knowledge that they require to put in a perfect control system in place. Unfortunately, that is also not the case. And it really is buyer beware. There is a lot of people out there selling technologies and selling various products, which they claim will solve your problem forever. And it is up to you to decide if that's actually true or not. I know I'm probably preaching to the converted, but sometimes it's worth repeating. So every facility is unique. Please do evaluate your facility before you decide on the strategy. Talk to other people who are already in this position and pick the best available technology for you, not for anybody else. So what options do you have? Well, for external structures which are in direct contact with the environment and for which you cannot isolate them, you have some reactive options, which is mechanical cleaning. People have been doing this for years. You basically can either use divers or you can dewater the structure and then do mechanical cleaning. You can also decide that you want to be proactive. You really don't want the settlement. And there are various antifouling coatings, both for steel and for concrete. The two basic flavors that we have had lots of success with is the non-toxic soft silicone barrier coating. The other one is the copper zinc based coatings, which are out there, both the ablative and non-ablative ones. Just make sure that the coating you are planning on using has EPA approval. In both cases, the lifespan of these coatings is a maximum 7 to 10 years. And then they will need to be refreshed. And it is not cheap to start applying these coatings in large volumes and on large surfaces. The coating market is changing very rapidly because of the ban of the tributyl tin. There is a lot of people out there with new coatings that need to be tested. If at all possible, please ask the vendors for multi-year performance data. That is really important because many coatings actually do fail after the first 12 to 18 months. Generally speaking, surface preparation is quite onerous, but it is essential to do it well, and the costs, as you can see here, are not inconsiderable. So if you're going to do a coating, do pick a one that is really good and do pick one that will last you for a few years. Here is an example of the two flavors of coatings we're discussing. One is here after 4 years and the other one is after 2 years. In a lot of cases, you will not actually have complete elimination of settlement, but you will have something that with just a brush of the hand will become clean again. So coatings are a good thing if you can pick the right one and if you can have a time and energy to prepare prepare the surface properly. Some of the vendors which have been successful are mentioned here, and it will be available on the website, so I shan't dwell on this. And keep going right along to the options for internal piping systems. Internal piping systems, as I mentioned before, are more of a challenge because you really can't get to them very easily. And in a lot of cases, they have lots of bits and pieces in line that can easily become plugged by debris. One of the reactive options for internal piping is thermal wash. Hot water works wonders. It is relatively inexpensive. It's considered environmentally benign, and it does a wonderful job. If at all possible, using hot water rather than a chemical molluscicide is probably a really good idea. In some cases, you are able to scrape the piping, so you're into mechanical cleaning, much like you are on the external surfaces. In some cases, when your system gets so plugged, as we have had occasions to face on the Great Lakes, flushing with weak acids that actually dissolve the shells and restore your system to some kind of functionality is also an option. The last one that I have here is oxygen deprivation, and basically if you can keep the system closed for any period of time, allow the oxygen to plummet, it will eventually kill the mussels. It's not as quick as the thermal wash, but it does work. Continuing with reactive options for internal piping, non-oxidizing chemicals, which people call molluscicides, but which are not necessarily specific to mollusks because they will kill everything else, fish included, have been used as a sort of a reactive treatment in cases where people are not able to use hot water or some of the other available options. Usually these chemicals are proprietary. They need to be detoxified prior to discharge and tend to be quite expensive. Of course, you require a permit before you can actually do this as well from your regulator. The other flavor is oxidizing chemicals, which would be the chlorine, bromine, chlorine dioxide, ozone. The problem with these is in reactive mode, you need much longer treatment than you do with the non-oxidizing chemical. On the other hand, these chemicals are non-proprietary, tend to be much cheaper, and in some cases, you might not actually have to detoxify the effluents at all. So in both cases, there are some pros and cons to these treatments. In case you actually decide that you do not wish to have any settlement in the internal piping of your facility, you have several options. One of the best options available out there is mechanical filtration, usually with self-cleaning small pore filters, which have been becoming much better as the years go by, and also sand and media filtration. Now, we have down here that you need to filter things down to 40 microns. That is probably excessively cautious, and there will be some trials being done on the lower Colorado River, testing 100 micron screens to verify that they are as effective as the 40 micron screens in preventing settlements downstream. If that's the case, then you're probably going to be looking at mechanical filtration as a much more effective tool than at the 40 microns. Either way, filters are not always the best strategy. If your water source is very high in total suspended solids, or if there are huge variations, or if the particle size is unusually, all concentrated in the 40 to 100 micron area, filters will have a tough time. So again, knowing your water source is something that you need to have in your back pocket before you start selecting a control strategy. Here is an example of some of the filters that are currently out there, the self-cleaning filters that I was speaking of. Basically, most of them come in this, they all look very similar. The key to a successful filter is the screen and how the screen is supported. Basically, you have to have a square mesh, preferably a woven square mesh, which is very well supported so that you can clean that mesh effectively with a suction system. So while we don't make any specific recommendations on the filters, we can make specific recommendations about what the filters have to have in order to work properly. They actually are able to work on very large systems. This is a filtration test that was done on Lake Erie, which is in the Great Lakes. It was able to filter 12,000 USGPM through a 40-micron wet mesh. It had an automatic backwash, which lost between 5 and 6% of the total flow in terms of using it up for the backwash. It performed pretty much flawlessly for about a year. The only problem was that we were trying to filter a huge service water flow, and we would have needed a much larger installation of these filters than we were able to get into the space available. One of the drawbacks of both filters and strainers is that there is, if they are not working all the time, they themselves may become a settlement substrate for a large number of mussels. And here is an example of a strainer that only works intermittently, and as you can see, it has since become heavily colonized by dry sennets. Another option for preventative treatment in piping is the use of UV systems. UV systems are being used for drinking water applications in many different locations. So again, it's a well-proven technology. Anything that kills the kind of drinking water pathogens that you're after will probably kill, not probably, but does kill, or disable dry sennet veligers so they can be used. There are some drawbacks to the UV systems. Obviously, the quality of your water is an issue, and seasonal variation in the quality is something to be considered as well. UV systems do come in installations that you can pop right into the pipe, and they have been known to work really well. If you use them or not, again, it's a consideration. Besides, UV system can be installed in piping. There is also UV systems that can be installed in open channels, and that has also been demonstrated as being very effective in terms of mussel control, again, on the Great Lakes. And, okay, we're moving on to chemicals. So we have covered the use of chemicals as a reactive treatment. In terms of proactive treatment or prevention of settlement, a low level of oxidizing chemical in the incoming water stream will discourage settlement of veligers in your system. And that oxidizing stream can be either chlorine or ozone, potassium permanganate or bromine. Basically, 0.3 milligrams per liter of an oxidant applied continuously or semi-continuously during the breeding season of the mussels has been shown to keep pipes clean in a number of different locations. This is an ozone trial that was done at the Bruce Nuclear Station on the Great Lakes, and this was a bit different because the ozone was only injected twice a day, but in much higher dosage. And basically, despite the fact that there was only two injections today for 5 minutes, we had the cleanest pipes on the Great Lakes. The other use of chlorine, as I mentioned, it can be used semi-continuously, where you're pumping it on for 15 minutes and off for 15 to 45 minutes. It is very effective, and it saves a lot of chemicals. The reason that we went to semi-continuous chlorine application is so that we were able to meet our discharge limits without actually having to dechlorinate the water stream. By switching the water stream by switching the chlorine between different water streams, we were basically able to cut the amount of total discharge by 75%, and that was enough to meet our regulatory objectives. In some cases, we have also looked at closed-loop cooling as one of the ways of isolating internal piping from the external environment and preventing settlement of mussels in these systems. Obviously, it requires a fair amount of redesign, and it's not something that you can do from one day to the next. So generally speaking, people who are facing infestations for the first time need to have a rapid response plan in place so they can cope with the first wave. And then they may have the luxury of time to decide on permanent treatment, or maybe the environment will be such that the initial population of the mussels will either die or crash or find that they're not prospering. So in summary, we feel that it's really, really important to know what the environment of your incoming water is like, how vulnerable your assets are. As the first control of choice would be a thermal treatment if possible, because it is probably the most environmentally benign. Use of mechanical coatings will minimize fouling of external surfaces, and installing self-cleaning strainers will protect piping from any shell debris that may be coming in. There is a very interesting product that's coming on the market. It's from Marone Organic Innovation Products. This is not an infomercial, but it is really interesting because it's the first new thing that we have seen in a very long time. What it is a bacterial product from a naturally occurring bacteria that is totally specific to the quagga and zebra mussels. It is now undergoing registration, and if the product is successfully registered, it may actually be a bit of a silver bullet in the fight against the quagga and zebra mussels. With this, I would like to thank you for your attention. I apologize once again for my delivery. It is really hard, I find, talking through a computer screen without seeing you guys out there. And I'll be happy to answer any questions when the time comes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Renata. Really appreciate that, and it was an excellent presentation. Up next, we've got Ronald Zegers. He's the Director of Southern Nevada Water Systems for the Southern Nevada Water Authority. Mr. Zegers has over 35 years of experience in research, operations, and maintenance of water facilities, both large and small systems, in the states of Missouri, Illinois, Louisiana, and Nevada. He has held positions of chemist, production manager, director, and general manager. He holds a Bachelor's of Science degree in chemistry with a minor in mathematics, and he's going to talk to us a little bit today about the workshop. And I'm going to turn it over to Ron.
Thanks, Shawnee. I'd like to introduce myself. I'm the director of the Southern Nevada Water System, which we're the operation and maintenance arm for the Southern Nevada Water Authority. The mussels were first discovered January in 2007 in Lake Mead. And I think a very recent article that just came out today where they have now discovered mussels in the canals going to Arizona. So they have spread substantially throughout the Southwest, as Ronaldo has shown. Next slide. Just a little bit of background. The Southern Nevada Water Authority is a regional agency. We provide water to 2 million people, and we have 40 million annual visitors to Las Vegas. We have two large treatment plants with a combined production capacity of 900 MGD. The one on the left is Alfred Merritt Smith. It is located right out next to Lake Mead. That's where my office is. So every day I get to overlook the lake. Great view. The other plant is the River Mountains Water Treatment Facility, which came online in 2002. The treatment technology that is utilized is we feed chlorine and ammonia prior to ozonation, and we do that for bromate control technology. We then dose at about 1 to 2 milligrams per liter with ozone, and then we go to direct filtration with no sedimentation in the process, and that's due to the high water quality that we get from Lake Mead. Next slide, please. Our average production is around 400 million gallons per day. We have 150 miles of transmission pipeline, 36-inch through 144-inch in size. We have 36 metering stations that we serve our five customers, and 30 pumping stations of size from 20 million gallons a day up to 600. Metering stations that we serve our customers are North Las Vegas, which is the Las Vegas Valley and the Las Vegas Valley Water District, which serves Clark County and the City of Las Vegas, the City of Henderson, and Boulder City, as well as Nellis Air Force Base. Next slide, please. The raw water infrastructure, which is susceptible to quagga infestation, includes five raw water pumping stations, 20 million gallon a day to 600 million gallon a day in size, 20 miles of tunnels and pipelines that provide raw water to the various facilities, pressure and instrumentation lines, surge systems, pump motor systems, and cooling systems. We discovered the mussels in our valves, check valves, and cone valves, which are our control valves on our pumping stations. Discovered them on instrumentation sensing lines. We elected to use stainless steel for water sensing lines, and this environment is ideal for the mussels. And then to the picture to the right, you can see our large surge tank systems, which were becoming infested after the mussels were discovered. Next slide, please. The slide here depicts our intakes into Lake Mead. We have pipelines to each plant which go to vertical shafts down into a well chamber, and then we have a tunnel that goes out into Lake Mead that comes up at about 1,000-foot elevation. The lake level currently today is around 1,100 feet. We withdraw water in to our pump stations, and those are designated IPS-1 and IPS-2 on the drawings. Because of the depth of the intakes and the current lake levels, we have always had cool water because all of our water comes in below the thermocline in the summer and in the winter months. So the average temperature has always been around 55 degrees that for the water that goes to Las Vegas. We have begun to experience warmer temperatures to the lowering lake levels. The lake levels in 6 years ago were at about 1,190, so it has dropped about 90 feet, and we would anticipate if the lake continues to drop, we will begin to get warm water and greater water quality problems associated with warm water. Down at the bottom of the drawing is a new intake that's under construction, which consists, again, of a new pumping station, which will have 600 million gallon a day delivery to the Alfred Merritt Smith plant, a tunnel that will be bored under Lake Mead for 3 miles and then come up so that we will withdraw water from an elevation of 860 feet. This 20-foot diameter tunnel will provide us a high water quality at the lower depths, and so that we will always be below the thermocline even if the lake level drops to 1,000 feet. Next slide, please. As suggested by Rinaldi, we did have a risk analysis done of our intake structures, and based on that analysis, we determined that there is a risk of quagga mussels surviving in our two intake pump stations to a moderate infestation degree. The likelihood of a massive infestation developing in IPS-3 is not likely due to depth. The parameter that it changes on us is the lake depth. Next slide, please. The parameters that Rinaldi evaluated for Lake Mead was the alkalinity of the water, the calcium carbonate, which would support an intense infestation. The chlorophyll levels are very low in Lake Mead due to the high water quality that Lake Mead has. the pH, dissolved oxygen, are generally in the moderate range to support an infestation. Summer temperatures are at 15 to 17 is because of the lake depth. If the lake level drops, our temperatures will probably go up to 24 or 25 degrees C. And the final parameter is the total phosphorus, which is very low in Lake Mead, which according to the evaluation would support little to no infestation. The current parameters have changed somewhat. Next slide. Coming into the intakes last summer during 2007, we saw a maximum of 98 billion villagers per day coming into our plants with an average of 22 billion villagers per day based on sampling on a routine basis over the summer months. That represents a high number of villagers, and what has happened in Lake Mead is that the villagers have been able to move around and have now infested the whole lake. They were first discovered in the lower part of the lake, but due to wind action and the carrying of currents caused by the wind, they have been carried upstream all the way to the inlet of Lake Mead and the Colorado River. We also monitor the infestation of the mussels around our intakes, and at a level of about 40 foot above our existing intake level, which is about halfway down, we have infestation of mussels at about 137,000 per square meter. We continually monitor our intake structures every 6 months, and the temperature is the parameter that's probably protecting us the most. And I think as Rinalda has indicated, that the water quality in Lake Mead is changing. Clarity is the best it's ever been since monitoring began back 20 years ago. And it seems that the mussels and their impact on Lake Mead are beginning to show the impact very quickly, probably due to the warmer temperatures. Due to the warmer temperatures year-round with a low of 55 degrees to 80 degrees, the mussels are able to produce 5 to 7 times per year, which is probably substantially different than the reproduction cycle in the Northeast for the zebra mussels. Next slide, please. Because we began seeing the infestation of the quagga mussels, we immediately began chlorination for our facilities in the raw water. That chlorination is working effectively to control them. We're using the low-level treatment of about 0.3 mg/L for one plant and 0.7 mg/L for the other plant. The difficulty that we have because of the ozonation process, we have to have a little to no residual going in the ozone contactors. So that requires us to change dosage rates on a daily basis due to production, chlorine decay, and detention time in the pipelines. We have experienced some problems with respect to destruction of our ozone destruct system due to the chlorine residual feed systems. But it has become effective with respect to controlling the quagga mussels. And since the start of the low dose rates, we have not discovered any quagga mussels within our plants. Next slide. Some of the additional measures that we're taking is that we are installing sample lines so that we will be able to inject the chlorine prior to the raw water pumping stations. Currently, all injections occur after the raw water pumping stations, and therefore we have not provided any protection to those pumps, motors, and water instrumentation sensing lines. That installation is occurring. We are also evaluating alternative control strategies and looking at coatings. The Bureau of Reclamation is doing a very large-scale study looking at coatings and products that will prevent the growth of quagga mussels in Lake Mead. Next structure, slide, please. Some of the costs that we have incurred to date are the temporary measures. We've spent close to $5 million in terms of temporary control measures. Permanent measures, we believe, will require a capital investment of about $24 million and an annual O&M cost of about $1 million. The large cost for the capital measures of $24 million is we are installing chemical feed lines and water sampling lines in the third intake. So we're in the three-mile tunnel. We will have chlorine feed lines that will allow us to chlorinate at the inlet to the new tunnel at low dosage rates. And so in order to get raw water samples, we also need raw water lines so that we can get raw water samples at the beginning of the tunnel. These long lines of high quality, since we're looking for a 100-year life, is leading to the high cost. Next slide, please. Just to give you a little bit of background, as Shawnee talked about, because the quagga mussel problem in the Southwest came on rather suddenly, and because we had little no experience, we put together a workshop of experts to give us presentations in the Southwest of the problems that they've discovered with the zebra mussels, and some of the control and techniques that they utilize to control the zebra mussels in the Northeast. Next slide, please. What we looked at, the presentations were quagga mussels in the West, optimizing chemical disinfection of the mussels, freshwater bivalve infestation, risk to assets, how they survive in warm water, and mussels and their impact to reclamation water systems. Since in the Southwest, there are a large number of reclamation systems that for water reuse, the impacts those reclamation systems serve golf courses and mainly for using reclaimed water. And there's anticipated impact on those reclamation systems of the quagga mussels. In fact, it has now been verified that two reclamation systems waters which delivered to golf course dams have now infested quagga mussels. Next slide. In addition, we had presentations on population behavior, assessment management of quagga mussels through modeling. We even had some presentations on winter lake drawdown as a strategy to control quagga mussels. Next slide. There were 32 invited guests, 14 experts, and 18 water agencies, wastewater agencies, and irrigation districts who were invited to attend the session. And the sessions resulted in research topics being developed in three areas. First one was chemical inactivation and barriers. The second area was population management in lakes, reservoirs, and canals. And the third one then was standard methods. What are the standard methods for sampling, identifying, and determining the mortality of villagers? And it was determined that there are really no standard methods for some of the parameters for sampling, so it was suggested that standard methods be developed. Next slide, please. The research needs identified in the chemical inactivation and barriers area was determination of the viability of quagga mussel villagers and assessment of chemical treatment efficiencies. Literature review and presentations during the workshop indicated that the CTs for mortality versus non-attachment of the villagers is not very well defined, and there are a lot of conflicts with regards to the amount of oxidant required and the quantity. In addition, the method to determine mortality is to look at the mussels and our villagers under microscope to determine if there's further movement. It was felt as if a procedure could be developed that utilized some sort of dye system to determine mortality. Studies could be done much quicker, so that was one of the recommendations. There was discussion about natural hydraulic effects on villager mortality, and those areas should be investigated because there were some systems who believed that they were able to achieve mortality due to hydraulic effects. The next item that was recommended was really providing vulnerability assessment and response management tool development, a risk guide that could be utilized by water systems to determine their risk with respect to impact of the quagga mussels on their systems. We also then recommended some non-chemical control strategies, which Rinalda talked about, and then further refinement of coatings and materials for control of the mussels within that project. Our next speaker will talk about the third area that was discussed in the workshop, which was control within the natural environment. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ron. We really appreciate that. That was a great presentation. Moving right along, we have Dr. Ricardo De Leon, who is with the microbiology unit of the Water Quality Laboratory at Metropolitan Water District of Southern California. He has worked for Metropolitan for 14 years and recently has been assigned as the program manager for the Quagga Mussel Control Program, a position which I'm sure has kept him quite busy over the last few months. And with that, I'll move right along to Rick.
Thank you, Shawnee. Glad to be here with all of you. What I will do is I'm going to build on two topics that were discussed earlier, one by Renata and then also by Ron, the second one, and continuing with the workshop outcome that we had. As part of the issues going on with quagga mussels, essentially what I wanted to demonstrate here is you have a picture here with mussels showing their characteristics. They have the ability to do siphoning. You see on the mussel on the left, mussel on the middle has an appendage that essentially it's their foot. They use that to move. And as indicated by Renata, there's Bissell threads also on these mussels that they use for attachment. These characteristics are important to know in understanding how they're going to behave in natural systems and in large conveyance systems, and for developing ways to take advantage of the limitations they have with their own characteristics, including attachment and mobility. Now, as indicated, the mussels were discovered in Lake Mead at the beginning of January 2007. And I wanted to put some emphasis here on how much this is likely to potentially impact the western United States, since this is the first known established population of invasive mussels in the West. Essentially, what's happened is between January and September of 2007, the mussels had already spread within four western states, essentially in the Southwest, as indicated by Renata. And later on in 2008, early of 2008, we had zebra mussel discovered in San Justo as well as in El Pueblo Reservoir in Colorado. And this is significant because it means now that we have two species of invasive mussels in the West that may utilize or overlap in their ecology and niches within different areas in the West. Now, as part of the discovery of the mussels, the Colorado River was essentially impacted. And what I wanted to point out to all of you is how quickly this development occurred in the West and how that is likely to impact other large systems. For example, these mussels were found at our intake in Lake Havasu, February 2007. They were at a density of about 1 to 2 adults per square meter, and this was, again, at the beginning of 2007. during that surveillance, they were found through Lake Mead, Mojave, Lake Havasu, as indicated, yet the surveillance didn't indicate that they have moved, they had not yet moved past that point into Southern California, for example. Nonetheless, as it turns out, they spread very rapidly. By July of the same year, they had sort of moved through a conveyance system into Southern California, our reservoirs, Lake Matthews and Lake Skinner. Many of you know those. And essentially, this represents what is likely to happen to other systems that move water in the western United States. Once the mussels get introduced and start reproducing, they are likely to spread very, very quickly. And that is why it is very important to develop essentially a rapid response plan. Renata alluded to this towards the end of her presentation, and it is critical that agencies have these response plans in place prior to the introduction of mussels so that they have a format for responding. One of the areas that is very important, of course, is detection activities, what is being done to be able to determine where they are, what is the distribution, what is the maturity of the colonies that have been infested. Coordination activities, because it requires interaction with many agencies, not just because of how water is moving, but because they are regulatory agencies that will have an impact on the activities that are done and the response component. And, of course, mitigation activities, which will be done essentially to have mitigation activities that address the short-term issues to minimize their spread and contain it as feasible, and also then later on have time to develop a longer-term control plan. The greater concerns, of course, are as these mussels are introduced into the system, it's essentially what is the what is called an infrastructure colonization. These are examples of small pipes within the aqueduct system in our pumps in the Colorado River, where they have a tendency to colonize areas that are small, where water has slowed down, and allow for them to settle in and start reproducing. Given the potential for that colonization, we undertook many rapid actions to manage them. One of the advantages of dealing with a large aqueduct system that's essentially conveying water through an arid environment like the desert was that we were able to utilize shutdowns that had been scheduled for repairs as a way to control and limit the mussel infestation in our system. The desiccation was very effective, and it allowed us to essentially treat very large sections at a relatively smaller cost. We also managed to do some dewatering of siphons that were scheduled for inspection and repairs, and so that also allowed areas that normally would not be dewatered to undergo a treatment, which in this case was essentially remove water away from a water organism. It also involved facility inspections, primarily to understand what are the possible areas that our system would be susceptible to colonization, given that each system is going to be a little bit different. It's important to understand where these initial vulnerabilities would show up so a plan of response can be designed and adapted as time goes by. Another response that we had is because we were managing a large aqueduct system and we had the Colorado River being heavily infested, and as Ron indicated, the number of villagers that were being produced within the system was indeed very large. It was critical to implement a system to help us mitigate and slow down the infestation of our system. And we initiated that by utilizing chlorine hypochlorous acid on trailers that were injected 5 miles within our aqueduct and then controlled villagers entering our system as a essentially a prevention plan that we used here. This slide shows an example of how those systems are now set up. These are now tanks, storage tanks, that contain chlorine. It is piped into the aqueduct system at the beginning of a tunnel so that we get the best bang for our buck by utilizing chlorine in the dark. And essentially at that point we have over 200 miles of canals that are going to be protected by that chlorine by reducing, again, the number of eligers that will enter the system. Here's an example of some of the issues that also need to be concerned in the West. It's been alluded also earlier that because they're reproducing and colonizing a warmer climate, it is unclear as to how many reproduction or spawning events they're having throughout a year. Most of the information from the East Coast points towards having a more defined season for reproduction and then a latent or slow season during the winter. Because we have wonderful weather in the West, we don't always have those seasons, and some areas in southwestern United States essentially are potentially susceptible to having year-round reproduction of these organisms. And so it is important for us to define those differences so that we can develop strategies that are going to be effective for us here in the West as opposed to those that have been used in the East Coast. For example, this is pictures taken by the Bureau of Reclamation at Parker Dam in Lake Havasu. The photographs on the left shows a plate, essentially a monitoring plate with mussels on it, and that picture was taken in August of 2007. But on the right-hand side, the picture shows the same plate pulled out of the water in November of 2007. So it's very clear just how quickly these organisms and these mussels are essentially reproducing and growing in warmer climates. Also want to point out that this is already into the fall season, where in areas in the East Coast, because of weather patterns, they would be slowing down already, whereas here they seem to be continuing. Because their growth has been so quickly in the West, we had to essentially clean the intake facilities there at Lake Havasu by utilizing divers that went into the water with power sprayers and remove mussels from the intake rates. What I wanted to point out in this photograph is that that activity was done in January of 2008, which is essentially 1 year after discovery. So that gives you a sense of how quickly you can get colonization in the West that would potentially start impacting water conveyance systems. This photograph shows a close-up of some of the areas and those trash racks taken in December of 2007. The yellow lines mark where the normal metal from the trash racks would be, which in this area is about a 3.5-inch opening between those metal bars, which are about a 3/4-inch thick steel. And you can see how the mussels have essentially grown over that area. Not all the trash racks were essentially covered to this intensity, and water was still moving into the facility, yet it was clear that some areas were getting intensely colonized. Now, as part of that removal activity, and Renata was indicating that you can have one of the responses is to do physical removals. And what you see on the left-hand side is essentially the pile of shells from the mussels that were removed from the trash racks and the chamber just inside the trash racks prior to the pumps. These activities are very extensive, labor-intensive, and time-consuming, and they're not really long-term the best solution for systems that are very large that will require extensive management through labor forces. Now, as part of our approach, we have taken what is called an integrated pest management viewpoint, where we're looking at treating the mussels essentially as a pest, and then looking at understanding how we could best remove the impact or reduce the impact that this pest would have in our system. The first component of it is, of course, to understand, you know, what is a pest, in this case, mussels, and which kind of mussels. The second step would be to essentially learn what is their life cycle and biology. This is critical in the West because there are going to be some changes to how they behave. They're not going to be major biological changes. They're still going to use the same reproductive processes, but the frequency and duration may be different in the West than in the East Coast. Monitoring is critical to maintain and understand how they're going to colonize and develop within the system, and that can be both conveyance systems and natural systems like lakes and reservoirs. It's very important to establish action thresholds. Those action thresholds will determine when a response is needed on the part of management to maintain those mussel levels at a level that is acceptable and that we can live with. Next step would be to choose management tactics which would afford a reasonable and sensible approach for maintaining mussels within boundaries of population and within, an acceptable level that the operating system can manage, and of course, evaluating results. Now, moving along to the second topic, which is essentially have alluded as well to natural systems like lakes and rivers. As part of this workshop held back in April in this year, there was a subgroup that addressed questions of how to manage mussels in natural systems, and by that we mean lakes and reservoirs where, for example, chlorine residual cannot be applied because of sensitive ecology and fisheries would be impacted. So the objective of this natural systems subgroup was to identify the key scientific questions for managing mussel populations in rivers and lakes. It was clear to identify where were technical and scientific knowledge gaps to be able to do that, since there really is historically no known effective control measures that have been applied to large natural systems. Only in a couple of very small lakes has there been a management strategy applied to them, yet those have been very limited and very small, and we don't have a true track record on how to manage this invasive mussels in larger systems. So what was needed was to develop a plausible yet feasible strategy to manage mussels in the natural environment. And our goal, as many of you know, is to take this information and then put it into defined projects, which are then utilized by AWARF for their own process system for determining priorities for funding in the long term. Now, some of the new information presented at the plenary talks, and Ron showed the outline that was used for the different presentations that were done by the experts that attended these meetings, four specific points were addressed or were consistently coming up in the presentation. One of those was that there was a uniqueness of the situation and lack of basic knowledge in the biology of invasive mussels in the West. And thus, the impact to the West is somewhat uncertain as to how one can compare costs incurred in the East Coast versus costs incurred in the West Coast by having to control the mussels. Ecologic effects also are going to be less known than they have been in the East, and those ecological impacts could be both to the biology and the fisheries, as well as shifting the way in which the algae populations will behave in lakes. Thus, the last step was a need for realistic goals, focusing primarily on control as a better term to utilize than the term eradication. Now, as far as the biology, most of the focus went in trying to understand what is the mussel behavior in warmer western waters. How was their lifespan? How long are they going to survive compared to the East Coast? What were their reproduction cycles? Those are critical because those will help determine what is going to be the spawning frequency and determine what kind of possible control measures could be implemented by water utilities receiving water from lakes depending on that spawning frequency. Temperature optimum tolerance, of course, is important. try to possibly take advantage of temperature as a way to manage the system in areas where it may actually get warmer than their tolerance, or at least too warm for them to effectively colonize and reproduce. Of course, their survivability under different conditions, the warmer water may make them more susceptible to certain diseases, and that's something that is yet to be determined. And the vulnerabilities to the local ecology may be different than how they impact the local ecologies in the East Coast. And whether or not the settlement, or what are called the cues for the petty villagers stay to settle, may be somewhat different here in the West than it has been in the East. So as far as the ecology, potential impacts on the foraging and food chain may be different. This concern now that we are dealing much more with endangered species regulations, what may be the impact on this from invasive mussels. As indicated before, there's an increased potential for pentlonic or attached benthic algae to grow and impact the water quality of those reservoirs. There may be an impact on operational controls, that is, dams and water conveyance systems that are within that system may offer an opportunity for having an effect downstream, i.e., would cold water released from the bottom of a lake change the manner or the seasonality for reproduction of the organisms downstream? And biocontrol agents, what would be the ecological effects and the effectiveness of use in the West? It was also discussed was the management of infested lakes, what technical information is needed to effectively manage mussels in lakes. That is something that is ongoing and needs to be developed. It needs to be determined how can conditions be changed to stress villagers or adults in a natural system. And that is something that for which there's, again, very little information and needs to be developed. And how can lake conveyance infrastructure be protected? Many of the outlet towers that are utilized for drawing water out of conveyance systems, out of lakes, are below areas where they can be effectively managed by divers or other traditional maintenance strategies. So new approaches need to be developed for managing those deep intake structures. And the third component mentioned by Ron that was addressed at this workshop was an issue of quality assurance and quality control for methods that are used to obtain information on population colonization controls and spreading. And although not everything needs to be standardized with regards to understanding the mussels, many of the observations are simply done directly, especially once the mussels have colonized. But in order to determine how could the mussels, where can we know that we're effectively controlling the mussels, we want to have enumeration methods that could be compared between one location to the other. That is, if Southern Nevada is implementing a particular control measure and determine a certain result of effectiveness, we want to be able to apply it in our own facilities, enumerate, and have a similar number based on utilizing a standard method. So for those, it could be used for enumeration. For sampling, it certainly would be very critical so that the approaches for assessing one lake versus another can be compared. And in particular, there's an interest in developing early warning methodology. That is, how could methods best be used to determine how to monitor for villagers so that a system would know if their particular source water is being impacted or exposed to mussels. And, of course, monitoring for adults to determine what is the earliest or what are the preferred locations that the mussels would first colonize so that a system would have as early warning as possible of that occurring. And with that, I conclude this presentation, and we'll follow on to the questions as time permits. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Rick. And we do have quite a few questions, so I want to thank everybody that has been giving us these questions. We're going to try to go through as many as we can in the time that's remaining. One of the questions that has come up is, I believe it's out of Oregon, and the question is, do all the chemistry parameters discussed at the beginning of Renata's presentation have to exist for colonization to occur? And this is a two-part question, and the second part of that is, can microchemistry environments exist that would allow a small colony of mussels to become established whereby the mussels can adapt to the chemistry and the environment and colonize? So if we can get maybe Renata to answer this, that would be great.
Okay. I think that, you know, there are some immutables. The mussels need oxygen, they need food, they need calcium, and they can't tolerate low pH. And I think the physiology of the mussels has been set over a very long time, and those requirements are, you know, pretty much set in stone. I think we have seen that some populations of mussels may be able to adapt to slightly warmer temperatures, let's say by 1 degree or maybe even 2 degrees, but that's about it. So I don't believe that possibility really exists, that if you have a low pH or marginal pH, that the mussels will be able to adapt to it. The physiology just does not lend itself to that, in my opinion, and you know, other people may disagree.
I guess as a follow-up to that, I know that in the Colorado area there has been a recent infestation of quagga mussels in Lake Granby, and the calcium in that reservoir has been reported to be relatively low, certainly below what has been reported in as a necessary calcium requirement. And there's supposed to be veligers that have been found. Do you have any kind of idea as to why there would be why we would be seeing veligers in a lake that has such low calcium levels?
Johnny, this is a really good question, and it is possible that those veligers are coming from an interconnected water source that may have better calcium levels. We're going to be going out to Lake Granby to have a look at that. There are different scenarios, but you know, you could speculate that the veliger was in a live well that came from some other body of water, and it was released from the live well of a boat that was on Lake Granby and picked up in the sampling device. I mean, you can speculate on those kind of things, and it is probably more likely than that there is an adult that is able to produce the veliger that can survive in a low calcium, low pH environment, because the veligers are actually even more susceptible to the environmental extremes than the adults.
Great. Thank you so very much. And I'm sure that everybody's going to be interested to see how that shapes up. Another question that has come in is there a natural predator for quagga mussels? And I think any one of you could be able to answer this, but I'll leave that open.
Well, we have found that both diving ducks and fish have been you know, feeding both on veligers in terms of small fish and on adults in terms of larger fish that have pharyngeal teeth in particular. And although there have been increases in the populations of diving ducks, it really didn't put any dent in the population that we were seeing on the Great Lakes. It may be a different story in the West, but it's certainly neither in Europe nor in the East have predators made a huge difference.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much. You know, we've got a couple of questions along this line, and so I'm going to just ask one of them. When chlorine is used, have there been observed increases in organics, TOC, and therefore increased disinfection byproducts?
Well, I guess we've been feeding chlorine, and as part of our strategy, we've normally fed chlorine, but we've had to raise the dosage. And, yeah, at one of our plant effluents, the THMs, actually doubled from about 15 micrograms per liter to 30, leaving the plant. Now, thus far, it has not created a major problem within the distribution system with regards to THM compliance, but we had seen an impact of THMs due to the changing application point of chlorine and the longer detention times prior to getting into the clear well.
Yeah, I wanted to add that so far, water from the Coyote River is fairly low in organics compared to other waters in other systems within the western United States. So other areas utilizing water higher in organics may find it more difficult to use chlorine as the primary source for control, and would have to evaluate other types of disinfectants that would then make a better or maintain that balance between the applied dose and the disinfection byproduct being produced in that water.
Fantastic. Thank you guys very much. Here's another question, and we've got a couple that are kind of along this line as well, which I will just give you the one. Given your vast experiences in control, would you see prevention strategies being more cost-effective than control or eradication for those water bodies without mussels? I guess question really falling on, you know, I suppose, Rick, if you could have prevented them, you probably would have, but certainly in terms of overall cost, what do you think is the most cost-effective? Certainly probably one.
Well, clearly not getting them into the system would be the best. And so prevention certainly is very critical in areas now here in the West, especially those systems that are not affected by mussels yet. And it's California actually has new regulation that requires water utilities to develop a prevention plan. So it is very much so. One of the things I wanted to impress during my presentation is how quickly they spread once they are in a large system. And so you can imagine just what are the costs incurred in responding to them and maintaining them at a level that is acceptable for water operations. So prevention clearly is the case, and with that, it's also a related question of what kind of outreach activities are mounted, and those are important to establish as well to understand what are the mechanisms by which this mussel is used to transfer from one location to the other. Renata indicated that in one of her slides, and I think it's important to look at those transport mechanisms and establish prevention mechanisms.
Great. Thank you so much. And I guess as a follow-on to that, I mean, if there was one thing that you would tell utilities that do not have these yet, what advice would that be, you know, in terms of what should people do, I guess, that currently don't have them?
Well, one is establish prevention mechanisms. The second one is to have a rapid response plan in case they do get introduced. And the third is to start looking at their infrastructure and determine what things could be done as they're developing new capital projects that would help then address the issue of having mussels in the system in the future.
I would add to that, and I couldn't agree with Rick anymore, but I would also add to that that I know that there are lots of different users of reservoirs in the West, but if you can close a reservoir which has no other means of receiving mussels except boating activity, to boaters or to boats from external sources, like maybe you could have boats that never leave the lake that people can rent to enjoy the reservoir. I think you could probably save yourself a huge amount of money.
I think that's great advice. And here's a great question. In waters with low calcium, can mussels attach and reproduce on concrete structures, obtaining their calcium from the concrete?
Well, I'd like to draw on the experience that we have in Lake George, which is a pretty marginal body of water in terms of zebra mussel survival. And there are some areas in Lake George where the mussels kind of hang on by their little claws and abyssal threads. And really the only way that they can survive in some of these areas is by drawing on the sources of calcium from the concrete. But periodically, if you have, you know, great rainstorm events which dilutes the water even further and depresses the calcium, they basically die off. And in this area, in Lake George, the mussel population has been anemic and surviving with very few individuals over the last 10 years. Basically, there has not been any increases. There have been some periodic decreases. So the short answer is yes, the concrete can provide some additional calcium that the mussels need. The long answer is it may not make any difference to the overall size of the population in that body of water.
Great. Thank you so much. And I think this will end up being our last question. Any questions that we don't have answered, please, I would refer anybody to our website after. We will have this reposted at the entire in its entirety along with questions and answers by the middle of next week. So here is our last question. Has anyone seen a difference in the effectiveness between the use of potassium permanganate or sodium permanganate usage for muscle control?
I have not seen anything in literature with regards to the sodium permanganate. The potassium permanganate control strategies in literature indicate that, you know, a one-part dosage for a short period of time will control the zebra mussels. There's little information with respect to quagga mussels. Like, the water quality in Lake Mead is of such a high quality that if I tried to feed one part of potassium permanganate in my water, the water would probably stay purple all the way through the process. And so right now, we haven't really looked at that technology yet. We are in the process of evaluating at the pilot plant. And based on the caller's needs, we'll probably look at the sodium permanganate. But although I do know potassium also has some impacts to the muscles and that may impact the potassium may be of greater benefit along with the permanganate to maybe suggest that potassium may be the best product to use as opposed to sodium.
Well, I cannot thank you all enough for all of your great wisdom and helping to educate everyone that has been on this webcast about the issues with quagga and zebra mussels. And thank you all so much for tuning in today. And this concludes today's webcast.